Has the time come to upgrade your home's Wi-Fi? Now that Wi-Fi 7 has been out for a while, why stop just there? And look into something like a mesh network and replace what you currently have. That's where the TP-Link Deco BE23 comes in. I'll be going over everything from general specs to how to control your Wi-Fi using the Deco app. I'm Wonder001, let's get into it. There are a few Wi-Fi routers that TP-Link makes that look similar to this, and some of them are in fact Wi-Fi 6 and not Wi-Fi 7. One of the reasons I went with the Wi-Fi 7 variant instead of the Wi-Fi 6 is because, one, Wi-Fi 7 is 4.8 times faster and has 5 times the capacity that Wi-Fi 6 has. It also has something referred to as multi-link operation, which allows multiple devices to simultaneously connect on multiple bands, meaning if you have a device that can support 2.4 and 5 gigahertz, it can combine those two to give you faster throughput to your device. Wi-Fi 7 also supports multi-user, multi-input, multi-output, which allows a Wi-Fi 7 router to communicate in a 16 by 16 ratio, meaning it can, instead of talk to one device, talk to one device, talk to one device, it can talk to 16 devices simultaneously in a burst, which is how you get some of those better throughputs and better stability connections to your devices. So if you're considering Wi-Fi 6 versus 7, those are part of the reasons that I chose Wi-Fi 7. And this particular Wi-Fi router is part of a mesh setup that I purchased for my parents because they were using the old Google hub and they only had a single node. So it was time to upgrade them. The Wi-Fi router itself is 5.9 by 5.9 by 2.4. As you can see, it is kind of a circular coaster shape. It is a little larger than I expected it to be. It is much larger than the Google Wi-Fi router that they had previously. Inside of this, there is a 4x4 antenna setup, which supports beam forming and signal boosting. All you need to know is if you have multiples of this, it will make it so that a device that's moving through your home will stay connected and have the speeds that you expect. The throughput that you get from this is 3,570 megabytes. That is not to say that you will get that all the time. It is split up over your two different bands. 5 gigahertz supports up to 2,882 megabits per second, while 2.4 gigahertz supports 688 megabits per second. That's why you have theoretical throughput between the two channels. Now, knowing what you have inside is kind of useful. So you are looking at a 1.1 gigahertz quad core CPU that's going to be operating the information to control this Wi-Fi router and other devices. It has 128 megabytes of flash memory. So that's where your firmware is going to sit, and has 512 megabytes of RAM. So it's not going to be a super gaming powerhouse. This Wi-Fi router is meant more for your everyday user who's looking to stream on multiple devices and, yes, do some gaming, but not use it primarily for that function. The coverage that you get from a single Wi-Fi node is 6,500 square feet. Now, I got this as a replacement for my parents to replace a Google Wi-Fi setup that I had for them with just a singular node. My parents only have a 1,400 square foot home, but their Wi-Fi access point is at the front of their house. They were running into issues in the rear of the house since it's just a long salt box where they were not getting good connection or speeds in the back of their house or even on their back porch. With a 2 Wi-Fi node setup, which is what I got them, one up front, one in the back, they're able to, one, get stable connection throughout the entire home, as well as on the back porch. And because of that secondary node being in the back of the house, it has actually extended well out into their yard now, which is great. Speaking of Wi-Fi connection, because this is something I got for my parents, the Wi-Fi speed test that I did is okay. Wi-Fi 7, you're going to get much better speeds than what I'm going to tell you about, but my parents don't have a service that gives you those greater amounts of speed. So when I tested this, it got 234 megabytes down and 36 megabytes up. Most people nowadays have much better than that, and this can support that. They just do not want to pay for faster, better internet. So that's the testing that I was able to do. If we look at the top of the device, there is a little deco branding right there. The front of it, you have a little status light there, but everywhere else it looks like nothing, honestly. The back is where you can actually see things. You have your dedicated DC power port, as well as two 2.5 gigabit per second ports, as well as a WPS setup button. If we flip things over, you can see there is a lot of breathing room for this, because that's to help dissipate the heat that this produces. Now, if we look at the bottom of this, when I tested it, I got about 116 degrees with it just hanging out. It's been streaming, etc. On the top, I was looking at about 101. So it's not a terribly warm device, but you have a lot of cutouts to help that heat dissipate from the Wi-Fi unit. There are four rubber foot pads to help keep it from slipping around on you, as well as a small pin reset right there. Now that we've gotten the basics out of the way, what's next? Well, that would be setup process to it. TP-Link makes it very easy to set up a deco device using their application. The setup for this was really easy. All I had to do was use the deco app, which is separate from the TP-Link app, which is separate from the Tapo app. This is a dedicated app that you'll have to download for this, but following the on-screen directions, it pretty much was as simple as plug it in, power it on, wait for it to produce a signal that I could then log on to in the application, set up the primary node, set a SSID name, set up the password, and then I could set up the secondary node and link it to the primary node after it provisioned itself, which in total, this probably took me about 5 to 10 minutes. If you're not as technologically savvy, you could still get this done in 30 minutes. Now, I did mention that there is an application, and this is the preferred method to interact with their Wi-Fi system. Yes, there is a web interface, but it's very similar to what you get in the application. So I'm going to show you everything that you can do in the application, because one, for me, I am monitoring this Wi-Fi setup remotely because this is at my parents' house. I wanted to make sure that I'd be able to keep track of everything that was going on, and having an app-based user interface was very beneficial for me. Let me show you what that looks like. This is the application for the Tapo Deco BE3600. This is your front page, your command center, as it were, to give you an idea of everything that's going on. You've got your network name, you've got your internet speed and Wi-Fi settings right here at the top. So if I select this, I can run a speed test, and it lets me know the service that it's actually using for the speed test. That was the privacy notice there. And you're gonna see, it's gonna go through a little animation. It's got a little drop down here if you wanna see previous tests, but I would not interrupt the test itself while it's going on. But there's a nice little animation kind of showing the download versus upload. See, right now it's on the upload, which is why it's going up. Green would be downloading in the opposite direction. And it gives you a readout, which you can share. So your download speed, your upload speed, your ping rate, your jitter. And then it gives you an idea of what can you do with these kinds of speeds. And if you scroll down here, it kind of gives you a history. There's your download, there's your upload, and then a running tally of when you did this. Likewise, if you select over here, it kind of puts that all in one place. So I like that it's up front, really easy to get to. We have our Wi-Fi settings. So you've got name, password, can show your password. You see this is a weak password because I have this set up at a friend's house and this is how they like it set up. Advance, well, you could see your security, your bands, your channel, and then if you want to hide the network. And then if we select share, it will give us a QR code that we can just simply show somebody and they can scan it and they can access. Here we have our MLO network. Right now it's off. This is the multi-link network, allowing it to kind of smush all the channels into one. They didn't want that. This is not in my house, so this is how they preferred things to be set up. Down here we could see everything looks good. It shows my download, my upload, 11 clients, and then network. Here's my hub one and hub two. And we could change the way that this looks so that it's more of a standard view as opposed to a mapped view. So notice in the standard view though, you can see signal strength, but also who's using up more bandwidth. So living room right now isn't doing much, but it has 9 devices connected to it. Bedroom has 2 devices, but is using up more resources. Selecting one will bring you further in, allowing you to see download and upload, signal strength, and the individual devices, as well as what that client is doing at that time, which is also accessible through here. I can tap on this and it'll bring me into that view. We have our online clients. Selecting this will show you every client that happens to be attached to your network at the time. Upper right-hand corner here, you can block list specific things if you wanted to. Selecting any one of the items will allow you to see signal strength, download, upload, set it as priority, set a family member. So if you want to create a specific profile for a family member, you could do that. You can isolate a device. I tend to do that with my IoT devices. Connection preferences, what it's currently connected to, what you'd prefer it to connect to, and then Wi-Fi preferences, and then mesh technology on or off. And then we could just block it right from here if we wanted to. We have our smart home integration right here. Not going to touch on that right now. We're going to come down to the bottom. That was all under our network. That was our command center as I described it. Then we have security. So no risks currently found. 3 security tips. You can select your scan details. So router security, firmware is good. Port forwarding, wireless security. So most of this is okay. It says that the password is weak and I would agree. You've got some free trials of web protection, intrusion prevention, and IoT protection. We have our Wi-Fi access control. So this is another place you can access your block list. We have our device isolation. Here I did isolate specific smart home gadgets that they happen to have. We have camera security. So you have add a camera for home mode or local mode. So what this will do is, regardless of what type of camera it is, this will kind of cut its connection when you're home. And this would, on local mode, any cameras added to this mode will only work on your local network and will be unable to access the internet at any time. So no talking out, just localized stuff, which isn't bad. Security Plus, you have your 30-day free trial of that, which are the things that we kind of talked about before. That's all under our security. We have parental controls. You would have to set this up for if we get started. What this will do is allow you to set specifics for individual devices based on a user that you create. So flexible time, content filtering, and online usage analysis. I like data, that would be kind of cool. And distinct profiles based on somebody's age. So we can go create now. We can say, yeah, we're gonna use this. This is blah, 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 blah. That's a name. And then you set a specific age. So we'll say 10 and then next. And then you would pick a device, select done. And now we have a profile. So blocked websites, we don't have any yet, but we can add keywords or websites for blocking. Web filtering, well, what do we want to block? You can see there's a lot to do. Won't dive into that just for YouTube purposes. You've got bedtime, so you can say when I set this. So every day, 8 p.m. to 7 a.m. I could turn this off completely. I can set weekends, weekdays, but notice weekdays/weekends and customs are locked because you need to upgrade to the advanced parental controls for that. Similarly for safe search and YouTube restriction and time limits and off time. So there are some benefits to this, but the fact that some of it you have to pay for, I don't know. I guess if you're a parent and need that type of restrictions, it's a good thing to have. On the go, this is a profile. This will allow you to manage your kids' online activity and content on the go, ensuring digital safety. So you would create another profile, allow you to set that up. Now I'm going to go back in here and it would show you a history of everything, but I'm going to edit this profile and delete it because I actually set it up for a digital picture frame. And like I said, my friend does not actually need parental controls. And then we have more. So more is going to show you the lab. So these are some features that are up and coming. They're in beta. You've got your reports, gives you a monthly or a weekly. So I can change that right here. You have your parental controls, something set up. You could see it there. Discover. Well, this is going to be discover other TAPO devices. QoS, well, this will allow you to set specific bandwidth limitations or priority devices. That's all done with that. You've got your VPN client, which you don't actually need. So Wi-Fi settings, this is just another way to access what we had before. Guest networks, you can set up a guest network simply by coming in here, turning on guest network and creating a password for it. It'll say Wi-Fi name and then guest network. You've got your IoT network. So if you really have IoT devices, you should slap that on and stick your IoT devices on that. WPS controls, see that they're enabled for that. Internet connection will show you your IPv4 versus IPv6 selections. Wi-Fi access control, again, this is going to bring you into your block list like we talked about before. Network optimization, so right now it's scanning to see if there's any interference with either the 2.4 or 5 gigahertz network. This is something that shows up in the reports as well, letting you know, hey, is everything working as it's supposed to? We have our test internet speed, so we ran one of those before. You have your VPN client. So here are the supported clients. Notice they do have most of the big names out there, as well as you can add your own. You have VPN server. So if you wanted to set up a server to act as your VPN, you can do that. Advance. You've got your operation mode, whether it's a Wi-Fi router or an access point, static routing, IPTV, VLAN, MAC cloning, DDNS, which you can set up. You got your LAN IP, DHCP server. Lots of information in there. Wireless network mode. You have optimal performance or high capacity. I have it on optimal performance for them. Address reservation. Not going to show that. Fast roaming, beamforming, and NAT forwarding. So that's all under your advance. You have your connection alerts. Do you want it to let you know if there's a new device or if the network goes down, it'll send a notification. You have managers. Right now I'm listed as the only manager, but if I wanted to give control over to them, I can add them that way. We also have our LED control. So I kind of wish that you could do this by a node by node basis, but you have either LED status lights always on, always off, or schedule. So I scheduled it during what would be their sleep time because they do have one of them in a bedroom. And then we have our system, which is going to show us MAC addresses things. Right now it's showing me the main living room. So we have our system time. It will show us our system time. We have update deco, which will check and see if there's any updates. And right here you can see the main one is letting me know that it's completely up to date. I can reboot. I can schedule reboots, which is really good. Or I can back up. So I can restore as necessary. That is everything that we can do for the TP-Link Deco BE3600 in the Deco app. Now that we've seen what we can do in the application, what's next? Well, for me, that's normally testing. You saw a little bit of my Wi-Fi speed testing before, and that's the best I could do with what my parents have at their home. But this is a powered device. So the question is, how much power does it use? Well, just plugged in, it uses 7.4 watts of power. If you have multiple nodes, you will just multiply that number and you'll get an average power usage amongst all of the nodes. Because I was looking for a simplistic Wi-Fi setup for my parents, I did end up going with this mesh router setup and have been very happy with it. But that does not necessarily mean that there are no cons to consider. First being, you may have noticed in the application that a lot of the extra services are pay to play. Unlike other brands, for me, my primary Wi-Fi setup at home uses Asus. A lot of the extra services are free. With TP-Link's Deco, they really want you to upgrade to those paid services. The other con is with the power source. And what do I mean by that? Well, here is our dedicated power supply. It's just shy of being 5 feet in length, but it has an unnaturally large power brick that is just offset. Really, really weird. I don't understand why. It's just, it's a pain to place. It took some finagling based on my parents' previous setup. TP-Link, why? Even with those two small shortcomings, if you have been looking to upgrade your Wi-Fi and are in need of a mesh network that is simple to set up and manage, then the TP-Link Deco BE23 is a good choice. If you are like me and need to remotely manage the network, the app is very helpful and straightforward. Despite having extras that need to be paid for, I feel for most people just looking to have a solid, no-frills mesh Wi-Fi network, the TP-Link Deco BE23 can be that. Because of that, I can strongly recommend it. If this sounds like the Wi-Fi 7 router you've been looking for, I will have a link where you can pick one up for yourself in the description area below. If you appreciate the time and effort that goes into making comprehensive videos like this, make sure to hit that like button to help other people find the video as well. If you like what I'm doing here and want to be notified of my next review, hit that subscribe button. Still not sure if this is the right Wi-Fi router for you? On screen now, you'll see two other reviews that I've done to help you make a more informed decision for yourself.